turn with me to the book of Revelation, because we're going to stay here. Now I'm just going to talk about it for a little bit. And we'll turn maybe to Revelation chapter 9. And then we'll have emphasis on chapter 10 in a moment. I think it was maybe a couple weeks ago. We talked about Revelation chapter 9, and in Revelation chapter 9, it talks about the fifth trumpet. Does anybody recall? Thanks. Okay, so we talked about the fifth trumpet in Revelation chapter 9. You guys remember how the book of Revelation goes, right? You got seven seals, seven trumpets, seven bowls, right? Okay, good, good, good. Okay, right now we're talking about the seven trumpets. The seals, always think about it in a way that God sees it. The seals is the opening up of the book of life. The seven seals, progression after progression, boom, you're being opened up. The word of the life, the book of life, opened up, opened up, opened up. Who can open up the book? Only the Lamb. Jesus Christ can open up what's inside of you. He knows what's inside of you. So there's a fullness of the life of God inside of man that's being opened up, bit by bit by bit. Will anybody give me a witness?
Amen.
Nice, strong, good. Now, after the seals, we go to the trumpets, right? We have now the seals been opened up. Now there must be a trumpet that is shouting. What are you shouting, guys? You're shouting what was just opened up. You're shouting what you just read. That's what you're shouting. I just heard that there's life inside of you. There's life inside of me. I am now proclaiming that truth that has been opened up to me. Okay, you've got seven trumpets. After the seven trumpets, you have the seals. Not the seals, you have the bowls. The bowls is the pouring out. It's the pouring out of what? It's pouring out of the blood. Sure, but there's nothing afraid of. The blood is not a scary thing. The blood of Jesus is not scary. Even when those who were crucifying Jesus Christ at the time, they said, let his blood be upon us and be upon our children. I'll say the same thing. So I'm not afraid of the blood of Jesus. I need the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
I pray let the blood of Jesus be upon me and my children and my grandchildren and, and everyone. Let the blood of Jesus, the only thing that can wash away the sins of the world. What can wash away your sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Let me pour the blood of Jesus on you. How many times? Seven times. Give me all of it.
Amen.
Give me every bowl. Oh, the bowl of wrath. The wrath of God poured out upon Jesus Christ for the salvation of the soul. You had to break the body of Jesus to get the glory out of him.
Amen.
You had to break the body of Jesus to get the blood out of him.
Right.
To purify you and cleanse you and make you holy. Man, pour every bowl on me.
Right.
And don't stop until you got seven poured on me. What are those seven bowls going to produce? It's me living what I believe. It's my changed life. It's it says a third of the grass will die, a third of the trees will die, a third. Yeah, let everything inside of me that does not belong to God die.
Amen.
Remember, man is made up of three components: spirit, soul, and body.
Right.
Spirit, soul, and body. Right?
Amen.
Spirit is holy and pure. The soul has been corrupted, but is being saved. And the body is just It's what's used to express your soul and your spirit. The flesh, there's nothing good in the flesh. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. This corruptible flesh must put on something glorious. But you have the three parts. Those are the three parts you constantly see. The three parts, those are three parts. The three parts is this, everything natural, everything corruptible being destroyed. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody want a bowl?
Yeah.
Another bowl is going to destroy another third part again. It's going to destroy the things that torment your soul, your mind, your thinking, your emotions. We talk about this again and again, but I tell you what, the emotions of man, they're up and they're down, they torment us all. Someday you're happy and you're singing, and someday you hate everybody around you. Somebody needs to save your soul, man.
Amen.
You're all over the place. Can I pour a bowl on you? It's just one bowl. Hey,
let
me pour a bowl on you. Let me save your soul. How? The blood of Jesus. Okay, so we're talking about trumpets, and in Revelation 9, we talk about the fifth trumpet, which is an ongoing proclamation of the revelation of Jesus Christ. The seventh trumpet is the full proclamation of our understanding. The seventh trumpet is, it is finished. The seventh trumpet is this: the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our God. That is the seventh trumpet. It's the proclamation that all things are by and for and through him. I know we say it, but we really don't believe it. But we have an understanding and a belief. We proclaim the seventh trumpet. Well, we've had the fifth one. Let's see. The fifth trumpet Revelation 9, verse 20, it says, okay, interesting. It says, the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues did not repent of the works of their hands, so as not to worship demons, and the idols of gold, and of silver, and of brass, and of stone, and of wood, which can neither see nor hear your war. Okay, the trumpets, remember, if you're hearing the fifth trumpet, you're still receiving the message of God. Your souls are being saved through the proclamation and the preaching of the gospel. Does anybody know scripture where it says God chose the foolishness of preaching to save man? Anybody hear that?
Yes.
He chose the foolishness of preaching to save man. So the trumpets is a proclamation. It's the foretelling. It's telling the things of God. So through the preaching of the word, the souls of men are being saved. In the fifth trumpet, it's not the seventh yet, so there's still a salvation progress. Salvation that's in progress, you know? The preaching of the word, saving your soul, saving your soul. God is saving your soul through the foolishness of preaching. Boom, boom, boom. But at the end of chapter 9, it says that they're still not repentant. They still haven't repented because the work is not yet complete. That's okay. What do you do then? Keep preaching. You don't stop preaching until it's done. You get the fivefold ministry. When does the fivefold ministry come to an end? When we're all perfect. You are all perfect, by the way. You just don't know it. But when you know who you are in Christ Jesus, then the fivefold ministry disappears. You don't only get to preach because the soul has been saved. You receive the end of your faith, the salvation of your soul. So the message is being preached. But in the fifth trumpet, it's interesting. And I take comfort in you guys. Let me read verse 21. It says, they did not repent of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their immorality, nor of their thefts. Something about sin and these descriptive words of sin. You know in scripture, it says that Esau was a fornicator. Esau was a fornicator. And because of his fornication, he could not inherit the kingdom or his birthright. What was the fornication of Esau? The fornication of Esau has nothing to do with something sexual, although in a spiritual place it does. The fornication of Esau was this. He forsook the things of God and took hold of something else. He thought the things of God were so light, and he had no regard for the things of God, or no regard for his birthright, that he settled for something else. He took something else besides the word of God. Scripture calls that fornication. So therefore, when you see murders and sorceries and immorality, these are just outward manifestations of spiritual realities. You know? God is just, is that all right, guys?
Yeah.
God is just saving us from what? All perversion, all sin, all brokenness comes from one thing. It comes from rejecting the word of God. You guys believe that?
Yes.
Go back to the beginning, Genesis 1. Everything stems from that. And therefore, you do not need to study sin and analyze it and break it down and realize where it came from and how it lives. And woo-wee! We'll talk about this, Pastor Phil. Tell me about your mother. Tell me about your brother. Tell me about your aunt. Tell me about your uncle. You tired yet? Because I am. I tell you, Jesus Christ is the Savior of your world. The answer is this, the spoken word of God will heal all of the woes of mankind. And we can spend all of our days defining it. Or we can let the mercies of our God be new every morning and forget what is behind you guys and just go forward to the glory of God. You know the lie that's perpetuated that you think you can figure out your problem? How many of you guys try to figure out the problem? Don't answer me, please. You might be the first one to raise my hand. Stayed up all night trying to figure this one out. How many of you guys spend your time trying to figure out your problem? Figure out how it happened, how to fix it, who said what, and how to counter it. Jesus Christ, the creator of all creation, came to save the world from all their troubles and all their woes. And this is how he forgave, this is how he fixes all the problems of man. He says, your sins. This is how you solve all the trouble of man. Forgive them. Forgiveness is the answer to brokenness. Forgiveness is the answer for sinners. Forgiveness is the answer for the separation between God and man. God came to the world to forgive them their sins. That's the answer. Forgiveness. Love. Go forward. Don't get caught in the trap of trying to figure it out. You can't. figure out sin. I don't want to go down that road. You can't figure it out. You can't figure it out. Well, I want to find its source. It's really the heart of man is the source. I got you. Just go on to glory. Go on to glory. So, we have the trumpets of God being blasted. The fifth trumpet of God goes forth. We said the fifth trumpet of God in 2 or 3 weeks ago. We said this was a picture of Pentecost. It's a picture of man coming into an understanding of grace and the kingdom of God, the powers and the glory of heaven. And we start preaching the power of God. But it hasn't had its finished work yet, because we see in verses 20 and 21, it says that there still has not been a repentance yet. There still has not been a repentance. But it's okay. Guys, it's okay. If there's things in your life that are not the way you want them to be right now, it's okay. It's not time. Hold on to that. It's not time. Be patient. What are you doing in the meantime? Just keep blowing the trumpet. Okay? You keep blowing the trumpets. Don't stop. Don't stop proclaiming the word and the truth of God. There hasn't been repentance yet. The word of God. Because at the end of the fifth trumpet, although the hearts were not fully repentant, there were still two more trumpets to blast. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, in Revelation chapter 10, why don't you throw that up for us, Brother Keith, and thank you for getting that for me. In Revelation chapter 10, the King James Version, I want you to look at it. Let's read through it, and then maybe we'll talk about it a little bit. Of course, we'll. Verse 1 says, "And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head. And his face was as it were the sun, and his feet as a pillar or pillars of fire. And he had in his hand a little book open. Interesting. And he said, his right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon the earth. I want you to see this. I want you to see the sea and the earth.